last Friday, Saturday and yesterday, whatever we have understood in terms of provisions of FEMA, we are trying to now implement and really understand the practical utility of what we have understood. And today's day would be far more fruitful for everyone, that you know, it will not only refresh our mind in what we have learned, but I'm also thankful to the faculty that first with Dilip Bhai, who always helps chamber in terms of guiding on FEMA. And noteworthy remark for me again, you know, that today Paresh Shah, the chairman, is going to lead this session. As the protocol goes, generally the chairman wouldn't lead the presentation. But he says that, you know, nobody, we could, in fact, at chamber, we could not find anyone who could have be ready to take up because of some assignments of preoccupation. And I was so glad that, you know, Paresh is going to take up this session. Having known him since many years and working with him personally at chamber, I have found him to be absolutely meticulous, has great ability to read between the lines of any law, and has tremendous potential and ability to comprehend the various nuances appearing in scattered law and then, you know, assimilating it in a proper place and giving a final view. But really, it will be a great session for all of us. And with these remarks, may I request President Yatin Desai to present him a memento as a mark of our respect and affection. Paresh Bhai, you are the baller and you are the batsman.
This is the solution and this is the problem, but we do not know how this is a solution, what is the process to arrive at this solution. And therefore, we make big mistakes in interpretation of the provisions of the law. And unlike other statutes, like penal statutes, which are literally to be construed as it is, as we learn from the interpretation of text, statute, the interpretation provision of the FEMA is a little different and it is a little diverted. And therefore, we need to look into and consider those aspects of interpretation of the FEMA. At times, you may find case studies very simple. As I mentioned to you, so don't misinterpret that we don't know the law. That much only I want to claim, nothing else. So, but when you know the process, you'll find that yes, we have learned a lot perhaps. And the objective of you attending the session is, my attempt is to do that justice. Also, if you know now, by now, that how to read the FEMA, you know the structure of the FEMA, you know types of the transaction of the FEMA, you know what is permitted, what is not permitted, what is permitted without condition, what is permitted with conditions, and what is known as a contravention, and what is the law to settle the contravention. With that riders and with that limitations, I want to explain you the case studies and the little bit of background to these case studies before we start the case studies. The Foreign Exchange Management Act, the overview. You already had an overview in the first session by none other but Manoj Shah. The overview which is presented need to understand that how this overall provisions can be interpreted and how the process of law will interpret this particular overall provisions of the FEMA and how meticulous they are and how nicely they are drafted and how badly they are drafted. So we will take the fundamentals of FEMA and what you should keep it in mind while resolving any of the doubts or any of the questions which are posed before you in the office by the client. The attempt would be to advise, how to advise client and what precautions must be taken and how logically this law has been framed. So my attempt will be more to explain the logic of the law rather than going through the technicalities. I would also not like to use the reference to the section or notifications to make it more cumbersome. I will simply say what is the law and how it should be used and interpreted and how the advice should be carried. Also, whatever solutions are given here are only a possible solution. They may not be right, they may not be wrong, but it is an attempt how to approach to the problem when a client is faced with the difficulties. So that is the attempt. So please do not consider the solution given here as a sacrosanct. It's only a possible solution. It's only an exploration that how can you read the law, how can you interpret the law, and can you help the client in reading the law like this. So this is the background which you already considered in the overview, that only section 1 to 9 are the substantive provisions of the law which deals with the transactions of the FEMA. The rest of the sections are administrative sections. Either they are dealing with investigation, compounding, penalties, appeals, the power making authorities to the various statutory bodies, repeal and civil. These are the broad provisions of the administration side. from section 10 to 49. So I will not build in detail on these projects. This is the further bifurcations of the provisions, how it appears and what are the utilities of these provisions. Section 1 says application and commencement of FEMA from 1st June 2000. Then section 2 is about definitions. Our normal understanding that the law prevails over the notifications and notification prevails over the rules. You may have to change your understanding little bit while you handle this situation on the FEMA. We will come to the specific when we come to the specific case studies and how we have to read this and how we have to forget what we have understood and what we have interpreted the text law. So therefore, the definition which are there in section 2 are the general definitions. In most of the cases, almost 100% cases, you will not find this definition repeated in the notifications. However, you will find the same word has or a phrase has been defined differently in the distinctive notifications. Now, PIO is defined separately in 4 or 5 notifications, which has a different implications. So therefore, this thing you must keep in mind. Then we have section 3 to 9, the substantive provision dealing in foreign exchange is section 3. Foreign exchange cannot be drawn is section 4 unless it is permitted. The permission to carry out certain transaction, the section 5. Current account transactions, you already learned that a current account transaction you can draw foreign exchange only as per schedule 1, 2 and 3, and if these transactions are not mentioned in schedule 1, 2 and 3, rest is free. All other transactions are freely allowed. Whereas section 6 on capital account transaction, only those transactions which are mentioned in the capital account transaction are allowed, rest is not allowed. So the exclusion rule is different for current account transaction and the capital account transactions. The only language which you will find that all the transactions of the current account transactions are free except 1, 2 and 3 schedule is only found in ADMS circular number 11, paragraph 6 of ADMS circular 2000, when the FEMA was introduced. Of course, by implication, we understand that rest of the transactions are free, but you will find paragraph 6 of ADMS Circular 11 very clearly mentioning that all other current account transactions are free and all other capital account transactions are not allowed. That's how we read section 5 and 6. Section 7, export and import has a specific importance. I will come to a case study and explain you what is the importance and what is the divergence in framing section 7. Then we have repatriation of the foreign exchange, that how much and when an Indian resident must get its right of a foreign exchange. And then we have section 9 dealing with the exceptions to the section 4 and section 8, that under what circumstances you can retain foreign exchange, you can use foreign exchange which is spent and etc. So these are the broad provisions of section 1 to section 9. This is nothing but what I have explained you. Then these are fundamentals of FEMA. When you advise client, what you must remember, and when you read the law, what you must remember. That the foreign exchange belongs to Government of India, except permitted under section 5 and under section 6 of the FEMA. Then second law is, not only those restriction of current account transaction under capital account transaction, but dealing in foreign exchange by person resident in India as well by person resident outside India is regulated. Dealing between the person resident in India and person resident outside India is regulated, which is section 3 of the FEMA. What it says, that when you want to deal with the person resident outside India in terms of receipt of foreign exchange, in terms of payment of foreign exchange, in terms of crediting the account of non-resident in India, in terms of debiting the account of the resident in India by non-resident is being regulated. It says it should be through a banking channel. You should not do any transaction in the currencies. You should do transaction in foreign exchange. It should be through a banking channel. And with a proviso that if there is a transaction of a compensating nature, you are doing some favor to a non-resident in India in turn to get a favor outside India or a hawala transactions. This transaction should not be done. They are restricted ab initio. So therefore, you find Section 3 banking channel because the transaction can be monitored only if it is to a bank. If it is in currency, it will not be able to be regulated, it cannot be tracked. And therefore, you have so much restriction on the movement of the currency, either Indian currency or a foreign currency, in terms of Notification 6 on export and import of currencies and foreign exchange, and Notification 9 on retention of the foreign exchange by a resident Indian. So that is about the dealing in foreign exchange and the hawala transactions. Then, the next fundamental is the transaction between resident and a non-resident, if it is in Indian rupees, is also being regulated. Why? Very simple. That if you are doing some transaction in rupee, in exchange of the favor which is not returned on the table or which is not returned in the books of accounts, then the government or the regulator will not be able to track this transaction. And therefore, even a transaction between a resident and a non-resident, if it is in rupees, it is also being regulated. Then, the last fundamental law, very important for the practice perspective, is that the drawer of the foreign exchange allowed in Section 5 by virtue of a current account transactions and a drawer of foreign exchange allowed by virtue of a capital account transactions are specific to the purposes for which they are granted. You cannot use those drawer of foreign exchange for the purposes other than for the purposes for which they are granted to you. So if, for example, if you are allowed a US dollar 10,000 for a private visit abroad, then it is not expected from you that you use this $10,000 for the formation of company outside India. You cannot use a single dollar for the purpose of forming companies abroad out of this $10,000. You are allowed to spend this only on the private visit, that is spending in foreign currency outside India for your private visit in terms of hotel expenses, in terms of convenience, in terms of handling or extending hospitality to your friends, etc. But no way any other purposes than what is granted. This is the fundamental, four fundamentals of the foreign exchange law which we have to understand and consider while interpreting any of the provisions of the FEMA. Is that clear to all? Very simple. Now, we come to FEMA practice. And what is FEMA practice is all about? When a client comes to your office, what he wants? Can I do this transaction without any hassle? Can I do this transaction without going to authorized dealer or without going to Reserve Bank of India? That is what a client wants at a starting point. So what you need to do is, whether the transaction which is explained to you by the client is falling under the broad parameters of the conditions which are specified under Section 5 or 6 broadly of the Act. That means whether this transaction is falling within the prohibited list or not of the current account transaction schedule 1, 2 and 3. If you are not falling in any of this schedule, you can say, yes, you can freely do this transaction. You can freely do this transaction. And if it is falling within this three schedule, then you have to guide them how to do this transaction. Similarly, for capital account transaction, if it is in the nature of investment overseas, then you need to look at notification number 120. If it is in nature of FDI, you need to look at FDI policy and the notification 20 of the FEMA. If it is in relation to the immobile property outside India, you need to look at notification 7 of the FEMA. If it is in nature of guarantees given to a non-resident, look at the notification number 8 of the FEMA. Similarly, if you are insurance policy, look at notification 12 of the FEMA. So this is how you look at each notification depending on the transaction of the client. So you should identify what types of provisions you must look at in order to enable you to advise the proper advice the client. So that's about a structure the transaction as compliant with the conditions of the automatic quote. That you have to structure the transaction, it falls within these conditions which are prescribed under section 5 and the section 6 of the FEMA. We have already mentioned that foreign exchange granted under both the section 5 as well as 6 is specific to the purpose. If it is not falling squarely within that specific purpose, it is not for that particular section, or it is not for that particular notification, or it will not fall within that rule. For example, if a foreign exchange is granted to you under LRS scheme, you cannot purchase the property outside India because it is prohibited. So if you want to purchase property outside India, you have to look for something else. And you will find that most of the notifications which are prescribed, most of the schedules which are prescribed within the notification are giving you a transaction in a very meticulous square jacket form, that only in this condition you can do this transaction. It is not general that you can assume something outside the box and do that transactions. For example, you learned notification 21, immovable properties. I believe you had a fantastic session with Natubai. That only individuals are permitted to purchase the property in India, either who is a non-resident Indian or a person of Indian origin. Regulation 3 and Regulation 4 respectively of 21. 3 is for NRIs and 4 is for PIOs. You cannot guide client that you own 100% Indian company and purchase the property in India. Very simple, because only individuals who are NRIs or PIOs are permitted to purchase the property. Now you are purchasing the property in the name of Indian company, saying that it is a resident entity, therefore you can purchase the property. Where is the FEMA? Here comes the interpretation of the FEMA. What is the interpretation law? The philosophy and the intention of the law is a preferred choice over the literal interpretation of the law. Therefore, you will not be able to purchase the immovable properties, even NRIs and PIOs holds 100% capital of the Indian company. Is that clear to you? Friends, lastly, it is a circular law, a very unique and a single piece of legislation in the world which runs by circular. The situation is so dynamic when you have foreign exchange law, when you have exchange control, that you should be able to change the law very quickly. In the nick of the hour and not when the water is under the bridge. Therefore, the entire law has been devised as a circular law. Section 63 of the FERA and the structure of the FEMA is designed on the basis of the need of an hour to change the law as and when it so arises. And therefore, the procedure of the law, the legislative intervention, should not come in the way of changing the law. And therefore, you find Section 48 of the FEMA and Section 63 of the FEA saying that a law can be amended by an issue of notification or a circular by the Reserve Bank of India or the Government of India pending the legislative approval by both the houses of the government, the Parliament, Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. Till whatever action is done under the issued notification is valid. Nobody can challenge the validity of this provisions unless this provision has been repudiated by both the houses or one of the houses. So this is the importance of circular law on statute. Now, here is an attempt, a very Herculean attempt by my office to summarize the entire transactions of citizen of India, NRIs of India, NRIs and the other entities. Because it's not to tell you that these are the provisions, but to tell you that when a client enters your premises, you do not know sometime what is the question before him. You must know the general provisions of the law in terms of current account transaction and in terms of capital account transaction, that what is generally permitted and what is a point blank bar. So this is the attempt here to specify the various transactions under the caption called citizens, NRIs and other entities. Because why NRIs? They have been given special treatment as our citizens who are abroad or person of Indian origin who are abroad. You must note one thing, that there is a mention of person of Indian origin in the Constitution of India also, and they have been given a privilege under the Constitution also, that somebody who knows Constitution better would be able to appreciate. So therefore, we have a special place for NRIs on the statute. So I am not going into detail of this provision because you already know this provision much more in detail than me. So therefore, I will not go into the details. But whenever we attempt to resolve the case studies, we will try and see what is mentioned here or what you learned so far. There is one corrections on this slide number 10. In FDI for foreign citizen, this is fine. In FDI for NRIs, I think number 3 will not be there. Sorry, number 3 is okay. 1, 3, 4, 5 is okay. Only I think schedule 5 will not be there for other entities on FDI because it is portfolio. Number 5 is not FDI. It's a portfolio, right? You have learned yesterday from Sabi Motorola. So, 5 is to be removed from other entities, FDI portion. Rest of the things are all right, actually. Why I'm saying this very importantly? These schedules are a jacketed formula. You cannot use this formula for any other purposes. If it is FDI, it is FDI. If it is portfolio, it is portfolio. You cannot mix, you cannot go cross border. You cannot use portfolio for the purpose of FDI, and you cannot use FDI for the purpose of portfolio. We will come to this later when we take the test. We come to the case studies. I have taken almost half an hour. I thought I have a lot of time. Hope this initial background was useful. Any question on this?
Immovable property, you said foreign citizen not allowed. Foreign citizen is a resident in India then?
See, we have considered NRIs and PIOs as a foreign entities. Right? Citizen is not an entity. NRIs, PIOs, we are not considering for any transaction resident Indian, right? Foreign citizen who is a resident India is a resident India, right? So we are not talking about person who is a resident India, isn't it? Resident India, FEMA does not apply by and large. A transaction done by a resident Indian, purchased by you, for example, is not restricted. So anybody who is a resident in India under FEMA is a resident Indian.
What I am asking,
yes.
Foreign citizen can also be a resident in India. So he can buy, right?
He can buy. But we are saying, in designing this column, we are not considering person who is resident in India. We have said in the first column, person resident in India, person resident outside India. You will not find foreign citizen who is resident in India in immovable property column